Historical Society on BCTV is underwritten by The Highlands at Wyomissing.
Good evening, and welcome to the monthly program of the Historical Society of Berks County for August 2013. My name is Sime Bertolet. I'm the Executive Director of the Historical Society of Berks County and your host for this show. As usual, joining me for this evening, seated next to me, is Joshua K. Blay, Associate Director and Museum Curator for the Historical Society. Good evening. Next to Josh is Kimberley Richards Brown, Director of Archives, Libraries, and Special Collections for the Historical Society.
Hi, Sime.
How you doing? And we have as our special guest tonight, Amanda Machik, who is the Director of Museums for the Boone Homestead here in Berks County. Welcome.
Thank you.
It's great to have you with
Thank
us.
You.
The Historical Society of Berks County Museum and Library are open Tuesday through Saturday, 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. We welcome you to join us as a member of the Historical Society and help us to preserve Berks County's historic legacy. One of the great things that we have in this community is a historic legacy that is shared by us, the members of Berks County, and only the members of Berks County, which is something to really be proud of. And we at the Historical Society preserve that legacy for this and future generations. And you can be a part of the Historical Society by joining us and helping us preserve that legacy. For as little as $55 a year for an individual member, or $65 for a family member, and the benefits apply to all members living under the same household, you can be a member of the Historical Society. And there's so many things that come with being a member of the Historical Society. For instance, you get our award-winning quarterly journal, the Historical Review of Berks County. It's been in continuous publication since 1935. It is really a wonderful, wonderful piece of reading material. In addition to that, you get notifications on upcoming exhibits, programs, and events at the Historical Society. You also get a voucher, one ticket, for our annual Four Centuries in Berks Historic Property Tour. So it really is a great way to learn about the community in which you live and the past. And I've mentioned about some of the great things that we have going on here at the Historical Society. As I said, you get advanced notifications on many of the programs that we've got going on, and I'd like to read a couple of them just to tell you a little bit about what we have going on and what you would be informed of as a member. First up is the Janssen Library Book Club. On August 21st, that's a Wednesday at 5 p.m., the book club is going to be reviewing a book called Founding Gardeners by Andrea Wolf, and Kim might tell us a little bit more about that later on. Admission charge is a nominal $5 a person. Then, our second Saturday programs. The second Saturday of every month, with the exception of July and August, we have a special lecture series. And for September, on September 14th, we have a prelude to our upcoming Four Centuries in Berks Historic Property Tour. This year, the tour is going to focus on Shillington and Cymru Township. And as part of that, the second Saturday program will be Where in the World is Cymru Township? By Gene Johnson, who is the Cymru Township Manager. In addition, since we're talking about Cymru Township, we have an introduction to Noldy, the family, forest, and factory, and that's going to be presented by the Friends of the Noldy. And that's going to be, again, a preview of our 2013 Four Centuries Tour. On September 20th, we also have the Janssen Library Movie Club. And again, that's a Friday evening, the 20th, at 5 p.m., and they're going to be showing To Kill a Mockingbird. $5 per person and all the popcorn you can eat. Then, a really special event's coming up on Sunday, September 22nd. And that's going to be a Civil War walking tour and benefit concert by the Ringgold Band at the Charles Evans Cemetery. This is really special. The Ringgold Band and the Historical Society have been friends for a long, long time. And on that Sunday, September 22nd, Mark Flum and some of his fellow reenactors are going to be hosting and taking people on 90-minute walking tours of Charles Evans Cemetery and pointing out all the Civil War historic figures that are interred in the Charles Evans Cemetery. They're going to start at noon, and they'll run every 10 minutes, one at 12 noon, 12:10, 12:20, 12:20, and 12:30. And those 90-minute tours will be conducted by reenactors in full Civil War dress, telling people about the historic events and personages that are buried at Charles Evans Cemetery. Then from 2 to 4, it's going to be the Ringgold Band, and they're going to be doing a performance and a program on early American band music as well as Civil War music from that period. So it's really going to be a great time. Tickets are priced at $15 a person. You can call the Historical Society to make your reservation. So that's one of the things you'd get notified of if you were a member, at least advance notification. Then, as I mentioned earlier, we have the Four Centuries in Berks Historic Property Tour. That takes place always on the first Saturday of October of every year. This year it's going to be Saturday, October 5th, and we're going to be exploring Cymru Township and Shillington. We've got some wonderful homes on the tour this year. We have homes that go back, early farm homes that go back to the 1700s, one-room schoolhouse from the 1800s, as well as time periods all the way through to a modern, very ultra-contemporary property. It's a great tour. You can call the Historical Society. Tickets will be available after Labor Day. You can call the Historical Society for details and to get ticket locations, ticket sales locations, and we encourage all of you to join us. It allows you to see some of the properties that you would not otherwise get to see because these are private homes. So I encourage you to look forward to the Four Centuries in Berks Historic Property Tour. And again, as a member of the Historical Society, you will get a ticket for the Four Centuries in Berks Historic Property Tour. So please give us a call, join the Historical Society, great organization, supports a great cause and preserves our history.
And one of the other many benefits of membership is also a 10% discount in our museum store for most items except for consignment items. We also have regular monthly specials in our museum store. If we have a chance to pan down, there's some items down there. Whether you're visiting the museum or the Henry Johnson Library, please don't forget to stop in the store. We always have a great selection of books, toys, craft items, whether it's a basket from our own Vicki Hefner or a book on Berks County history, you'll be hard to walk out empty-handed. Members receive an extra 10%, so it's a 20% total if you're a member. And on sale this month, in coordination with our Civil War exhibit that just opened, is a whole bunch of series of items of Pennsylvania 150 Civil War items for the sesquicentennial of the Civil War. Some shirts, mugs, and playing cards. Playing cards are pretty neat. I picked up a deck last summer when we did the road show.
Yeah.
It's hard to believe it's already a year ago. But a lot of the cards have anecdotes of Pennsylvania's connections with the Civil War. It's really good, great deal, and very educational, too. So play your own poker chips.
Well, you know, while we're on the subject of memberships, not only the historical societies, but also BCTV. If you're watching us tonight, you're watching us live, okay? And BCTV provides a format like that where you can call in. If you have questions, you can call in. It's an interactive venue, and we encourage you to call in, and you can do so by calling at 610-378-0426 with your calls, with your questions. BCTV is a treasure here in Berks County. It's the only program like it, and allows you to participate and know what's going on in your community, and we urge you to support BCTV.
And for only $35, you can become a member of BCTV. Your year's membership will help them continue bringing you local programming. Please mail your check to BCTV, 645 Penn Street, Reading, 19601.
Sounds good. Now let's see, Kim. What's going on over at the Johnson Library?
What's not going on at the Johnson Library?
Always busy, I know that.
We are, because we are in the middle of our summer rush. Well, first off, as Sime said, on August 21st at 5 o'clock, the HJL History Book Club will meet. August's book is The Founding Gardeners, The Revolutionary Generation, Nature and the Shaping of American Nation by Andrea Wolfe. It basically takes a look at the founding of the country through the eyes of Washington, Jefferson, Madison, and Adams, who were
wow.
all avid farmers, and it's amazing how much hands-on work they actually had in planning out their own farms and doing their own gardening. It's a very good book. We highly recommend it.
That was really prevalent at the time. The Founding Fathers were very, I mean, they took the lessons that Leonardo da Vinci talked about, and when he talked about, you know, laying out a garden, how systematic, how mathematical it was, they took it to heart. Well, they were all men of the Enlightenment.
Right, and as they're being stationed over in Paris and England, they're taking garden tours. They're really, at this point, just devouring anything that's written about farming, and they're really setting the stage for American farms. And really, you know, as I know, at one point Jefferson was trying to dispel a lot of the rumors about, you know, nothing grows here, or, you know, all that stuff. And so they're through Bartram's garden, you know, Bartram, they're sending seeds and flowers and trees over to England. So English gardens were actually becoming American gardens and all of that.
Yeah, it must have been mysterious from the New World. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's
yeah,
neat.
They kind of set the stage for all of that. So it really is a good book, so you should check it out, even if you can't come to the discussion. As a heads up, our October book is The Immortal Life of Henrietta Lacks by Rebecca Skloot. And that's more of a scientific look. Apparently, her cells were stolen and used in a lot of scientific investigations for cancer and diabetes and
so this is more contemporary.
It is.
Okay.
The family didn't know about it, and you know, her cells still live on, so that's kind of cool. And February's book, and this is a big heads up because everybody's going to need it, we are doing David McCullough's John Adams, and I think it's like that thick. So we're giving people plenty of time to read it. On September 20th at 5 o'clock is the movie. September's movie is To Kill a Mockingbird. This will be, depending on the attendance, will determine whether or not we continue the movie club. So if you're interested, come on out and support us, or it will go away. For both the book club and the movie club, it's open to the public. We ask that anybody who participates bring a brown bag dinner and make a donation to the library's Adopt a Collection Fund. It's $5. We are currently raising funds to finish boxing our ledgers and scrapbooks. I brought that on a couple months ago, but to kind of show some stuff off, I brought some things that will need to be boxed. Your donation is going to a worthwhile preservation cause, so come on
It'll
in.
It'll pretty much last forever, too.
It will.
Good idea.
Yeah. While our start time is at 5 o'clock for the book discussions, we usually pick it more up around 5:30, closer to 6. So if you can't join us at 5 o'clock, stop on in anyways. And we are also trying to grow our Henry Janssen reading list, so if you have any suggestions, just email me. My email address is krichards@berkshistory.org. We're also beginning work on our third annual archival series program. We've got a really good suggestion okay. that we're batting around that might, if it works out, include a little wine tasting.
Good.
So look for that. We're opening the floor up to for ideas. If you have any ideas that you'd like us to present on, or if you have some ideas that you would like to present, give us a call. We're going to do the series between February and April this year because January always seems to have a little bit of snow problems. You can contact myself or Lisa Adams, who's my assistant, at 610-375-4375, or you can email me at krichards@berkshistory.org. Other than that, we're just...
What do you got in the collection? What'd you bring us?
I brought some examples of why you should come to the Henry Janssen Library to do your research. A lot of people still do not know that when you come to the library and request something, for the most part, you get the original item. We do make a few exceptions, which I brought tonight, but you get to actually hold history in your hands. A lot of people don't understand that, and it's one of the best things about the library because a lot of our items are over 100, 200 years old.
What's the oldest piece we have? Do you know?
Deed from 1714 along Oley Creek.
Really?
Mm-hmm. And the property was surveyed in 1712.
So 300 years. Mm-hmm. Well, 299 anyway.
Yep. So, I mean, you never know what you're going to, we never know what we're going to find. We're still doing that inventory. So check the website, too, because we should have an update on the inventory soon. But one of the things that I brought two things that are kind of important, and one of which came from the county, our county commissioners. This is the 1760 tax list, and these are on microfilm. But you can see why we want boxes for these, because they're falling apart and they're all handwritten. And I always bring these out for kids who are touring the library, and they're like, oh man, you know, hand cramps. They can't believe that people actually took the time to write all this stuff out.
And look at how good the penmanship is.
You know, what's interesting about the tax list is, you know, if you're doing genealogy in Berks County, you realize that there's multiple spellings of names, and the names are spelled numerous ways in German and numerous ways in English, and they're always going to vary, so you always have to know the variations of spellings. But, you know, this, it's always, it's just fun kind of reading through there and seeing it's really the only record, along with the church records, that somebody was here at the time. And the earliest...
What's that one dated?
This is 1760. Whoa. I think the earliest ones are in the vertical files, and they're about 1732.
That's 253 years old.
Of tax records.
Well, what's that one?
This one is cool. This is also, this keeps coming into question. This is the Oath of Allegiance for Berks County. This is the book that people got signed into when they took the oath during the American Revolution. And it actually wasn't just the American Revolution. We had to do some research on this. They had no way of actually determining when a person became an adult and, like, official, like, landowner or whatnot. So what they did is they requested people sign oaths. So when your German ancestors or anybody else came over off the boat, the first thing they did was they swore allegiance to whoever the king was at the time. And then during the American Revolution, they would sign, you know, they would take the oath of allegiance to the new country. And these records here are what help determine your admission into the CAR, SAR, or DAR.
At the time or now?
Now. Yeah, because it proves that you were here and it proves that you were working for the American cause. And this is one of the documents that they need. Hmm. And I had a research request the other day asking about these. And I'm like, well, we have the original oath. And they're like, well, no, we need it from this book. I'm like, this is the book. this is all we have. You actually, you can see it on microfilm. We've created an index so that we know, we can look in the index and know immediately if your ancestor's in there. But this is really cool. And actually, the oaths of allegiance continued up until around the time of the Constitution, because after that, it's written into the Constitution as to when you become of legal age to vote and to hold office and all of that stuff. And then the oaths of allegiance went away.
Are they by date?
Yes.
Okay.
And they're also by the person who administered the oath.
Oh.
So they didn't have the same people. They had different magistrates administering the oath.
So if I wanted to look up Bertolet, and they could have had a bunch of ways to say, you know, Bertolet, Bertolette.
We figure, was that, that's had like half of a Lee.
Yeah, I guess we're a couple of it.
there might be a couple in here, but, and it was actually Miles Deckant, who was one of our volunteers. He's part of the SAR, does a lot of research for them, actually came across a conundrum the other day where he found, the person he was looking for listed in there twice. So then we had to try to figure out, well, did they take the oaths with other people in their neighborhood? So we weren't really able to determine which one was which.
Is the Oath of Allegiance in there? I mean, we've talked about this before.
We have. There's a small little one of a little version, but there's a book out that we have... yeah, it's I hereby certify that the person's name have taken and subscribed the Affirmation, Allegiance, and Fidelity according to an act of the Assembly, you're going to make me read, of Pennsylvania, in that all may be provided witnesses. And then it's like my hand. This is the one that Peter Spiker did. So it's the 29th day of September, 1777.
So that's the one that Peter Spiker took?
Mm-hmm. So he affirmed that they were, that they hereby affirmed. But we have a book of the Philadelphia Oaths, which also explain what the Oaths of Allegiance were, and it actually lists out the different oaths that they would take. Because wow. somebody actually reads it, and they stand there. It's kind of like the naturalization stuff.
Now, what's so wild is that you just mentioned Peter Spiker, who's the one that administered that oath, and we were talking about the Four Centuries Tour a couple of minutes ago, and back in 2008, Peter Spiker's house in Stouchburg was mm-hmm. on the
I
tour.
I missed that tour by a week. I started the week after.
Well, yeah, that's right, you did. Well, you got to spend the day there. Yeah. So that's good. That's great.
So, but if you come into the library, other than, you know, we, on a very rare occasion, like BCTV, we don't really bring this out, but it is on microfilm. But for the most part, whatever you want to research, you come in, we'll give you the original stuff. You know, not that many people get to hold history in the palm of their hands, and you can do it every day at the Henry Johnson Library.
Yeah, and it is neat. I mean, when you talk about, we talk about the historic legacy of Berks County, I mean, we house that. I mean, that's it right there. And that's, you know, we take that stewardship very, very seriously at the Historical Society, and we're glad that you're helping do that, Kim. Thank you. What else?
I think that's all I've got for
tonight. That's pretty much it?
Yep.
Okay. Well, then if that's all you have, then I think we ought to move along to our guest tonight. Amanda, you're here to tell us a little bit. We welcome you to the show
once again.
And it's great to have you with us. And we want to know a little bit about the Daniel Boone Homestead, both past, present, and future. What's, you know, mission, you know, how you got started, a little brief history, you know, what you're doing now and where you plan on going. And I got to say, too, that my two colleagues here seated to my left are also on the board of the Daniel Boone Homestead, so they are well represented here tonight.
Reforce.
There you go. Anyway, welcome.
Thank you. The Daniel Boone Homestead is, of course, the birthplace of Daniel Boone. He was born there in 1734. And only spent about 15 years of his life there before moving south to North Carolina with his family. And then after they left, the Malgridge family purchased the homestead and lived there for about 20 years. And then the home was purchased again by John de Turck and his family. And they lived there into the 1800s. And so those are the three families that we interpret today. When you come out for your tour, we talk about all three of them. It's not just about Daniel Boone. And the mission of the Friends is to interpret the life of Daniel Boone, the experiences of the Maugridge and the Turk families, and the settlement, development, and culture of the Ole Valley in the 18th and early 19th century, and to provide recreational and educational opportunities to the visitors of Pennsylvania and the community.
Right.
So we do also, in addition to the history that we offer at the Daniel Boone Homestead, we offer recreational opportunities, overnight camping for scout and youth groups, fishing, running, biking. We have equestrian bridle trails. So anything and everything, just about.
Where's the fishing?
In the lake.
Oh, okay.
The Daniel Boone Lake was built specifically for the sawmill. When that was moved, the Bertolet sawmill was moved, I think, in the 1960s.
Okay.
And so the lake was built to be able to run that.
Neat.
They used to have public swimming there, too.
Okay.
Well, we don't anymore.
Yep.
Yeah. No swimming. Just fishing.
Okay.
Too many snapping turtles in there for that. So we do have a variety of events every year. We have about 1 to 2 events every month. Our big event that is coming up in just a few short days is Battles at Boone, a Revolutionary War encampment. That is August 10 and 11, and it runs from 9 to 4 each day. There will be a small morning tactical or battle at 10:30 each day, and then the grand reenactment will be at 2 p.m. Each day. In addition to the battles, there's going to be military demonstrations, British and Continental camp tours. We're going to have colonial vendors or sutlers that will be selling their wares both to the reenactors but also to visitors that may be interested in purchasing items. Colonial and early American music, blacksmithing, gun building, textile processing, hearth cooking. There'll be toys and games for children, crafts for children, militia muster activity. So all different types of activities and demonstrations.
I was there for the, as I mentioned earlier, I was there for the F&I, French and Indian. I guess that was maybe back in 2005. That was a huge thing. I mean, how many people are you expecting for this?
This one's not going to be quite as large.
Okay.
This is, we're expecting between 100 and 150 reenactors and participants. This is the first time that the encampment is being offered by the since the Friends have taken over the historic operations of the site. The site is owned by the Pennsylvania Historical Museum Commission. They've owned it since, I believe, 1937.
Okay.
However, in late 2009, early 2010, due to drastic budget cuts, they eliminated their four museum staff, leaving just two maintenance employees to manage the property. It is almost 600 acres. It's one of the largest properties in Pennsylvania, largest historic properties in Pennsylvania. And as a result, the Friends of the Daniel Boone Homestead, which is a 501c3 volunteer organization, stepped up. They hired myself and two other part-time employees, and they already had one employee prior to that, so now there's four of us.
Okay.
And we are responsible for all the historic operations, so all the events, the daily, you know, daily tours, all the facility rentals, pretty much anything that's museum or historic related. And then the PHMC and the two maintenance staff that are still there, they take care of the buildings and the large property maintenance issues.
Okay. When they, like I said, it has been a PHMC site since the late since the 1930s. And you mentioned this several families, the last being, I believe it was the Deturks who lived there. When did, how long did they live there through? Do you know that?
The Deturks, I believe, were there until 1820.
Okay.
John Deturk died in 1808, I believe, but I think his family still owned it for several years after. And then it went through a variety of hands. It was it had apartments at some point. It was sort of like a boarding house, I think.
Oh, really?
Wasn't grandmother or grandmother born in the house?
Yes. Our current president's mom was actually born
at
home. And so when the state acquired it in 1937, they had to restore it back to what they believed to be its original appearance. And the house as it stands now, it's a large, fairly large stone home, and it does not look like it did when Daniel Boone was born there. He was born in a log cabin. That actually was built over a spring cellar, which is still there, and that current home is built over that same spring cellar. So the spring cellar is the oldest part of the house, dating to when Daniel Boone was born.
But it, I mean, I always say, like on the Four Centuries property tour, we'll get some houses that were, you know, from the 18th, 19th century, and you know, they've been modernized. But I always say, well, you know, even the people in the 18th and 19th century, I mean, they like modern conveniences. I mean, they didn't, you know, they didn't want to hang in the past, and so that they modernized and they applied with the times. So that's, I think, natural. I don't think there's anything wrong with that. But my question, you know, did the house stay in pretty good shape up until when the PHMC took it over?
I believe so. It was inhabited for most of the time.
So it didn't sit vacant or...
I don't think for very long, no.
Okay.
There might have been a brief period. Some of the really early photos from the 30s, it does look, you know, it's not in the best shape, but it wasn't, you know, falling in on itself or anything like that.
So. When you do your programming, and you look at your educational programming, I mean, that's a big part of your mission. Like I said, is there any way, is there a theme other than Daniel Boone? I mean, do you keep it along that theme, or do you branch out and do and explore different areas for your programming?
We explore different areas. We have all different types of programs. We recently started having a Halloween event and we're actually expanding on that this year. We're doing a haunted homestead tour.
Oh, neat.
Led throughout the property, and that's October 26th. It's going to be from 6 to 9 p.m., and then we have our trick-or-treating event, which is the following day, and that's for, you know, younger children and their families, and they can go around to all the historic buildings and trick-or-treat, face painting, pumpkin painting, scary stories, things like that.
Okay. That's great. Well, we have two home viewers, so if we could have the first home viewer. Are you there? Home viewer. We might have dropped him. Do we have a home viewer on the phone?
Hi, how are you?
Good.
I apologize in advance for my ignorance about the subject, and maybe you already covered it because I just tuned in. But Daniel Boone Homestead, is that where he was born?
That is correct, yes. He was born there in 1734.
Okay. And where did his family come from originally? Did they settle in Pennsylvania originally?
They settled closer to Philadelphia, and then his father moved out to the Ole Valley.
And then Boonesboro, is that in Kentucky?
Correct. That is what Daniel Boone settled. After he left Pennsylvania, he moved south to western North Carolina, and from there made his, you know, several trips through the Cumberland Gap and eventually settling in Kentucky at Fort Boonesboro.
Okay. Yeah, I wondered which was his birthplace and then his homestead, like where he's finally settled. So you've settled that for me. Well, thank you. Thank you so much, and thanks for all the work you do.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Thank you for calling. Do we have another home viewer? No, we're good. Okay. So you had... That was great. So you do have the education programming, and it's, like you said, it's for all ages, I guess. So you have the encampment that's coming up, and then you have your Halloween fair, and that sounds interesting. On Boone, say again, when did he leave Berks County?
1750.
How old would he have been at that point?
15 and a half, roughly. Yeah.
He didn't really lead the vanguard then.
No, he would have. I mean, he moved down with his parents, and actually several other families, including the Lincoln family, actually migrated south.
Mm-hmm. Right. Okay.
And settled in Rockingham County, Virginia, near Harrisonburg.
And he did come back to visit at least once, right?
Twice.
Yes,
I think
right.
1781 and 1788.
Okay.
And actually, that might be a good lead-in. We recently, the Friends recently published a book on Daniel Boone's boyhood adventures in colonial Pennsylvania. This was debuted on May 5th during our Children's Day event. Mm-hmm. And I wrote this on behalf of the Friends, and it was published here in Reading locally at Aperture Press. It was illustrated by a local artist as well. And this book is told through Daniel Boone's eyes to his son Nathan when they visited Pennsylvania in the 1780s. And it talks about his childhood here and, you know, some of his adventures as a boy, his friendships, you know, learning to hunt, learning to trap, and kind of acquiring that early sense of adventure that we saw him with for the rest of his life.
That's great. Do we have another home viewer?
Hello?
Home viewer.
Yes, I'd like to ask a question. I can remember watching your show a few years ago. I don't remember when it was. You had somebody on, and he was talking about you can go to some place or some website about aerial views of this area.
I can help you.
And do you have them in there at the Historical Society?
We do have some aerial views in the collection, but there are a few websites you can check out for aerial views.
They had one on there. It showed Maple Grove.
Yes, that was through me. There's a couple ways you can look at some aerial views, especially in Pennsylvania, but even outside of Pennsylvania. If you go to Google, there's two ways you can do it. One is Penn, P-E-N-N, Pilot, P-I-L-O-T, Penn Pilot.
Uh-huh.
That's the way you can get some aerial views. And there's another way you could do it. Type in historic aerial photos. And I think the website might even be historicaerials.com. I was just using that this afternoon. That's another way you can do it. But both sites, they just don't have one time period. They have multiple time periods of aerial photography you can look at. And you'll be finding yourself getting lost there for hours, like I am often.
Did you ever look at the Daniel Boone Homestead back from 1940 and whatnot?
That's a good question. I know I have not done so yet, but not yet.
Well, maybe you should tell the other ones. They're three quarters of that board. They can look at them from 1940 or wherever.
Certainly. We'll have a look. Thank you for the suggestion.
You know, there's also, and I'll plug one of my colleagues in one of our other organizations, and that would be the Historical Society of Bucks County. As I understand it, they have the collection of AeroService, which was a huge aerial mapping organization, company out of Philadelphia. And my colleague, counterpart Doug Dolan, said that they have that collection. So if you're looking for, I don't know whether you're strictly looking for Berks County or whether you're looking for aerial mapping, they would be another one, aerial photography, they would be another one to check into.
Okay, that would, and they go back how far?
Oh, I would say, I know AeroService. I mean, they were, I think they got formed right after World War I. I mean, I knew the man that started that business, a fellow by the name of Virgil Kaufman. But yeah, they go way back. They go way back, very early aerial photography. And I think up through the 1950s, 1960s.
Uh-huh. Wow, good. All right, then. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.
Well, thank you for watching. Appreciate it.
Okay. All right, bye.
You bet. Anyway, what else, Amanda?
As I was saying, we have the Revolutionary War encampment this weekend. More information about that and all of our events and programs can be found on our website, which is www.danielboonehomestead.org. We also have in October our big fall festival, our Heritage Day, and we're also going to be featuring colonial beer brewing demonstrations.
Ooh.
This year, as well as other 18th century hands-on activities and demonstrations, quill pen writing, candle dipping, gardening, food preservation, horse-drawn wagon rides, and again, that's October 20th. It's from 10 to 4.
That's great. Well, man, it's been wonderful having you on the show tonight. We really appreciate you being here. And like I said, Daniel Boone Homestead is such a vital part of Berks County. It really is. It's a treasure to have. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Oh, it's been great. I guess we need to go to a break. Okay, why don't we take a break right now? We'll be back in a moment.
You're watching the Historical Society of Berks County on bctv.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For other information on local heritage societies and local history, go to bctv.org. The Historical Society of Berks County on bctv.org is underwritten by the Highlands. To find out how you and your business can support a program on BCTV, go to bctv.org.
Welcome back. That was a great portion by Amanda. Really appreciate the Daniel Boone Homestead being with us tonight. But now we're going to get back to the Historical Society. We're going to talk about some of the exhibits and some of the things that Josh has brought us from the collection to show you what we have in our collection. Josh always says we got about 20 to 25,000 artifacts.
Just about.
Only about 30% of which are on display, so he's got a lot of stuff to pull from. Anyway, go ahead.
Sure. Well, I thought I'd bring some pictures. If you were with us on July 13th for the exhibit opening of the Civil War, you certainly would know it. That was a very, very good day, a very busy day for us. Thankfully, we didn't get in trouble with the fire marshal, one of our good friends at the fire marshal's office, but it was a very good day for us for our opening up our new Civil War exhibit. the last full measure, Berks County at War, 1861-65. I know Vicki, if she gets the chance to see this program, she'd appreciate this photo. But we had some young members of the Children of the American Revolution chapter helping us out with keeping the people informed and what have you. Our speaker was Dr. Valeska, professor at emeritus from Kutztown University, speaking mostly on the experience of the Pennsylvanian Germans in the Civil War, and Gettysburg in particular. And we really had a great crowd for the auditorium. Gentleman in the middle, we owe a heck of a lot of thanks to. We owe a lot of thanks to many people, but certainly this gentleman in particular, Mark Flum, and a lot of the members of the Civil War Roundtable. Mark Flum is your go-to guy. Any question you have on the Civil War, if this gentleman doesn't know, just about probably no one will.
And they're going to have, you know, Mark is great.
Yes,
because
yes, yes.
We talked about, I mentioned earlier, that Civil War Charles Eddon Cemetery walking tour. Mark is one of the reenactors who is going to be at that tour. And again, you know, if anybody knows it, it's Mark.
I got a preview tour, a little bit of Charles Evans, because some of these personages that we talk about in the exhibit, we really don't have too much on. So we took some headstone photos of Charles Evans, and there really are a lot of people in this exhibit that are Charles Evans, but there's so many more we just couldn't talk about. So come see the exhibit before you go on that cemetery tour. It'll really help you give some context. But even if you can't make it to the exhibit beforehand, you'll enjoy the Civil War tour of Charles Evans without a doubt. Just had a nice crowd. We had a lot of good graphics done. We work very well with a local company. And a lot of these are really neat. Unfortunately, I didn't have a close-up here this evening. All of these broadsides come out of our archival collection. Thank you again, Kim, for your patience. This really neat one here in the middle, half of it towards the bottom, it's in block English above, but then it's in German below. Not Pennsylvania German, but German
below. High German.
High German. So that was very interesting to bring that to the exhibit. And of course, we can't go through the exhibit without mentioning our good friend Judge Stallone. He has a very personal connection to one of the batteries, and he was very proud of it and helped us out with a lot of some material for the exhibit. In this case here, everybody loves the gaudy stuff. They said they can't bear to look at it, but we borrowed some really nice pieces from the National Civil War Museum in Harrisburg, a medical kit in particular. We also have Revolutionary War era Bodo Otto's medical kit, which is ours, on display as well. If you compare the two, there's really not much difference between the 90-year history and sign. What'd you say they could get a bone off in about?
I don't know. I've heard that they take a man's leg off or an arm off in a minute or two, something like that. I mean, they had to be quick.
Yeah.
But it's, yeah.
We've got some surgical saws and stuff. So we recommend you come first thing in the morning or give you a chance for your lunch to digest before you check out the medical case too close, because there's some grisly tools in there. So we'd not only talk about the guys who fought in the war, this case is also devoted to some of the surgeons. There was at least 36 surgeons and assistant surgeons for Berks County who served, not to mention the young boys, the youngest who served of the war, who acted as stretcher bearers and as well as drummers during the battles. Neat piece down there. We have a blanket on it now, but a neat piece. It's the technical term, but it's a gurney as well as a bed. There's a,
it's a stretcher, isn't it?
Yeah, but there's another military term. It's on the label. Come see it. And we are ever so pleased to welcome Joanna Dweischer from Reutlingen, Germany. Every August, we host an intern from our sister city in Germany, and Joanna is our intern this year. She's helping us with a number of projects, and she's also helping us to research the history of the relationship between our two cities, which sometimes I think we sort of neglect it. It'd be good to have it on paper, but she's ever so pleasant, and her host family's taking her around to like the peanut bar. I'm sort of threatening to take her to Shady Maple to get the true American experience. We'll see if that works out.
But it really is. That Reutlingen, and I really want to thank former Mayor Tom McMahon, for really keeping the Reutlingen, what we call the Reading-Reutlingen friendship team, you know, alive and viable. We have a great relationship with Reutlingen, and they love coming here. Unfortunately, we don't get to go over there as much as we'd like to, but Mayor McMahon really put this together this year and brought it over, and the Historical Society is very proud and happy to be part of that and providing an intern an educational experience and showing her, you know, a lot of what the legacy of Berks County and Reading is like. So we want to thank Mayor McMahon for that. What else you got?
Another way for members and non-members alike to stay informed of what's going on at the Historical Society, Kim Brown and Kim Longlot have really stepped up our Facebook page and also our Twitter. We have regular postings, regular shares of engaging history of the area and also shares from other places.
Yeah, we're much better with Facebook than we are with Twitter.
Twitter. I still don't understand Twitter, I got to tell you. But anyway, that's beside the point.
I submit content on Thursdays, and Kim Longlot, who posts my information, she usually gives me, in good humor, a bit of grief because Twitter has a very short character limit. But your image link for the picture even
it
takes away,
as a character.
Which is a pain. Yeah. But anyway. I follow a major museum in England, and they seem to be having some fun with close-up images, so I started doing a little close-up series. So it was last week, and also, find us on Facebook. Our Facebook name is Historical Society, all one word, space, Berks County, all one word. So have a look up and make sure you follow us. But for our non-Facebook viewers out there, I started a little series called Close-Ups. I'm going to take a close-up of an image of the collection, and see if we can find people to guess what it is. We had about 10 responses. One of them came pretty close. This is actually a close-up of a beautiful landscape. And what's amazing,
that's
too...
That's a Devlin?
No, this is actually a razor.
Oh, that's a razor, okay.
I'm continually blown away by the picture quality on my iPhone here, but this photo actually here and this photo here was taken on my iPhone. Now, this is right
put
here.
Put your pointer on it. Yeah. Oh!
Yep. I got it right close to the landscape. It's a beautiful landscape, circa 1862. This is actually looking from Penn Street as it was, mm-hmm. right about the time of the Civil War, which is another neat connection for our exhibit.
You bet.
Looking north along the Schuylkill Canal, which goes up north that way. Then on the other side, you have the Linebox Hill and also the Union Canal. This White House right here was a lock tender's house on the Union Canal. And of course, you have the Linden Valley Railroad Bridge. But the reason I brought this up recently, we had this restored, and it looks so much better than it did. And it'll be going back on display, too, and we'll be figuring in a larger Schuylkill River-themed exhibit next year. But there's so many detail between the canal boats and the industries along the east side of the river. And the canal enthusiasts also like this as well, because as you can see, the Schuylkill and the Union Canal were on either side of the Schuylkill River proper down here. But this little bridge right here, it's a water level control sluiceway. It kept the water at a certain level for the boats. So you
right where that bridge is.
Right where the bridge is, where the gentleman is standing. So that water is draining out of there. But that close-up is of Keystone Iron Furnace. Keystone Iron Furnace was located on the north side of the Lebanon Valley Railroad tracks, which was on the east side of the Buttonwood Street Bridge. This is the Buttonwood Street Bridge here. Here's the Lebanon Valley Railroad tracks coming out of the city. And this is the remnants of the Keystone Furnace, which later became a property for Reading Iron Company. Over here, some of you might recognize as American Shining Cable. American Shining Cable took over from another plant called the Reading Steel Casting Company in 1920. I'll show you a couple more modern shots here to get an idea of the lay of the land, but this is where that Sun Rich Foods is now.
Oh.
American Shining Cable, they closed in the late 1980s, I believe. They made a lot of, mostly valves, but a lot of specialty steel castings. They also made components of the George Washington Bridge. So if you ever drive over the George Washington Bridge, there's components of Berks County in that bridge. That's the Buttonwood Street Bridge.
That's the Buttonwood Street. So Sunrich would be right in there.
Yes,
okay.
Sunrich is right about here.
Okay.
These houses are no longer here. There's a Hewitt was one of them, and Clinton Extension was another one of them, but those houses are no longer there. But in the bottom left here, you see the remnants of the piers that were associated with that iron foundry.
Huh. Do you...
And here's that iron foundry, as it would have been.
Do you, what's the date on those this picture and the one before? Do you have any idea?
That's a very good question. This has to be right before World War II or even before that, because this was closed by like the 1930s, I believe.
Okay.
And they took it down shortly thereafter. Then also during World War II, they built a more modern railroad bridge. This is the original Lebanon Valley Railroad Bridge, which the strikers burned in 1877.
Okay.
This bit here, which was iron at the time of this photo, this was originally wooden, and that's the portion they bridged. That's the portion of the bridge they burned in 1877 when they had the railroad riots relating to the cut right outside BCTV studios here.
So what's it looks like a quarry or a sand pit.
This is actually, and I didn't realize this until I looked it up on a map this afternoon, in our archives, another very good source material. This is actually when they would make the iron over here, they had slag.
Okay.
And exactly.
That's a slag pit.
This is a slag pit. What they would do is they would grind up the slag and use it for roofing material. They would use it for street building material as well. What's funny, the new bridge they're building in Birdsboro, old 82, now 345, they used to have a connecting ramp down to the ground. It's gone now and it's barricaded off because they're building the new bridge. They were still moving slag out of there from the old brick foundry 40 years after the fact. So this is a slag company. You can see they're grinding it up and sending it out on railroad cars from slag from the foundry there.
Neat.
And this is one thing you must do.
Sanborn
fire maps. I get lost in these all the time.
They're online now too, aren't they?
You can get some of them online, yep. And you can get some of them on microfilm. But
they're like 20 to 30 pounds a piece.
So. And they're massive, massive books. But they are so neat because they have all these neat little layouts of streets and building composition, what have you. So this is a layout of the Reading Iron Company's Keystone Furnace. Reading Iron Company took it over. So that's the insurance map valuation of this property. Like, for example, these trestles here where they drop the coal and coke for the iron company.
Right there. Okay.
And that's what you see the remnants for in this other photo right here, all these concrete piers.
Aha.
After that was gone.
Neat.
What's neat here, too, you can see the House of Good Shepherd up here.
Yeah, sure you can.
And Showboat.
Showboat.
And Parish and all the right here. I just, like that gentleman called before, I get lost in aerophotography all the time. And of course, this is also pre Westshore Bypass. So along here, you can see remnants of the Union Canal, which Westshore Bypass took it all away. Now, what's there today? Just about nothing except for Sun Rich Foods. But if you would look...
Is that a Google map?
Yeah, this is a Google Maps. American Training Cable would have been right here, and this is the Sun Rich Food building right here, and right here would have been those other streets. They call it the Buttonwood Gateway Center now. It's a Keystone Opportunity Zone for industrial development now. But American Training Cable is right here. I remember that building was still standing for the longest time after I came to the area. Then they raised it, and they're also trying to put some other industrial plants up here. This is where that Keystone Foundry would have been, right through here and that other slag place. Now, the interesting thing is... back in the day, before DEP and concerns of environmental impact and what have you, apparently, American Training Cable, they used to X-ray their products, and there was a very nasty chemical, which was a byproduct of that they would dump right outside the back door, basically, right alongside the Toon Trail, which is right where the Schuylkill River is. There's an area that they can't touch for about 80 years because it's...
Contaminated
area of basically a nuclear hazard. It's a low, very low level, but...
Well, Josh, that was great, but unfortunately, we've come to the end of our program. Thank you. I'd like to tell all you friends, you are our friends, that we thank you for joining us tonight. We ask that you tell your friends to join us and watch the program, too, and also, again, membership to the Historical Society. We'd love to have you as a member. Please join us. If your friends missed this program... It's telecast again, rerun, on Friday, this coming Friday, at 10 p.m., Saturday at 6 p.m., and the following Sunday morning at 7 a.m. We encourage all of you to join us. We thank you for your support, and we look forward to seeing you next month when we'll have some big news from the Historical Society of Berks County. Thank you.